Hi everyone, thanks for having me. I'm honored to be here, and thanks especially to Cammy Roth for setting this up and inviting me to come speak about my experience here. It's always a great opportunity to speak about these trips, and I've enjoyed getting ready for this presentation because it makes me reflect back on this experience and think about what I'm doing, think about why I do it, because that's a good question to ask sometimes, and you'll get a little more perspective about like what am I talking about, because there are some moments on this trip that I took to Pakistan where you'll be like, why would you ever do that? But first, I wanna ask you all a little bit about the Capstone program, and I'm hoping someone could tell me a little bit about what it is exactly you're learning in this class, and what the purpose is, and what relevance I have coming to speak to you. So what is it that the Capstone experience is teaching you, and what are you learning through this class?
We're trying to connect different forms of science between us and our normal day lives. We're taking different angles, different presentations that we're giving to us. So.
Okay, nice. And any other thoughts, or what have been the great learnings through taking this class? Sorry?
Psychological stuff, like PTSD.
Okay.
Post-traumatic stress disorder.
Yeah. So am I right in understanding too that it's about like learning about real world experience, kind of giving you a view of like maybe something you'll go on to do in the future, and giving you a perspective of where you may go from here?
Useful science.
Yeah. And in this case, yeah, maybe a useful career. I have this quote from a guy named Walter Bonatti, and he speaks to the potential futility of mountaineering. So some people might ask the question, like, why do you climb mountains? What is the purpose of all of this? And I think he speaks kind of eloquently to that. And he says, "For me, the value of a climb is the sum of three inseparable elements, all equally important: aesthetics, history, and ethics. Together, they form the whole basis of my concept of alpinism. Some people see no more in climbing mountains than an escape from harsh realities of modern times. This is not only uninformed, but unfair. I don't deny that there can be an element of escapism in mountaineering, but this should never overarch its real essence, which is not escape, but victory over your own human frailty." So I got into climbing originally just because it was always something I was really drawn to, and nothing like inspired me more in the world than to go climb. I liked school. I did pretty well in school, but it was never really my passion. And so whenever I had the opportunity to go climbing or get outside and go on an adventure, like, that's what I wanted to do. I went to a boarding school for a couple years, and anytime I had the opportunity to go into the mountains, that's what I did. And I found a way to make this a living for myself and make a career out of it. And, you know, I climb mountains, but I have health insurance, I have a retirement account, and I do this all through climbing. So I like to share that just to say that, you know, you can do something that's more obscure and still make it a career and still have a normal life doing something different. So anyway. The experience I'm going to share with you was a trip I took to the Cherakoosa Valley in Pakistan this summer. And there were four of us who went there, and we were going to try to climb this peak called Nafi's Cap, which is a drawing that a friend of mine did of it. And we were trying to do a first ascent of it. We would have been the second party to ever climb to the top of it, but the first to climb this particular route we were trying on it. So I have a video that I'd like to show that just gives you a sense of what the experience was like, and then some slides afterwards that I'll elaborate on a little bit more and go a little bit more into depth. So what we're doing basically is we had to fly all to Islamabad, Pakistan. We met up there, then we took another flight to this town, Skardu, and then we got in a Jeep and drove to the end of the road. And I've always had this feeling of when I go on adventures, I always want the road to be a little bit longer and for the journey to continue and continue, because it makes it seem more exciting the longer the journey is. And on this particular trip, by the time we got to the end of the road, I was ready to be there. It was a long enough trip. So a couple things that are worth introducing before I go into the video, I think, are that there's some terms you might hear us talking about that you probably won't understand, some climber lingo terms. One of those terms is alpine style. And so when we talk about the alpine, we're talking about like the alpine ecosystem, which is way up high in the mountains. And alpine style climbing is when you climb without like fixed ropes. So if you've seen videos of people climbing Mount Everest, they fix ropes and leave them there, and they use the ropes to ascend up. And our method, our intention was to climb without fixing ropes, to carry just the things that we needed so that we could move a little bit more fast and retreat. So alpine style is the way we were trying to climb. Another term we'll throw out is splitter, and that's a reference to the cracks. So when a crack is like perfectly splitter like that, it means really good. It's kind of it's just like awesome. And then the other difference you'll hear people talking about is aid climbing versus free climbing. And free climbing, some of you may have heard that term and think like, oh, free climbing, that's when you're climbing without ropes, right? But it's actually not. Free climbing is when you're just climbing the features on the rock without using protection to pull. So like protection is like cams or pitons, things that you can stick in the cracks, and then you can attach a sling to them and pull up on them. And our intention was to just climb the actual features on the rock. And so with that proposal and the intention, we were awarded what's called the Lyman Spitzer Cutting Edge Grant by the American Alpine Club. And it was awarded to teams like ours that wanted to move in alpine style to do first ascents in like far ranges of the world. So we got funding from the American Alpine Club and also from this British outdoor company called RAB, and from NOLS, the National Outdoor Leadership School where I work. So thanks to those companies. And without further ado, I'll start the video. Are there any questions before I jump into it? There will be more time for questions later. But, okay. Maybe it's worth saying too, I was at the climbing gym just before I left for this trip, and someone asked me, you're going to Pakistan? Like, why on earth would you go to Pakistan to climb? And this was right after the Bin Laden episode happened, so it was a valid question. But the reason people go to Pakistan to climb is it's kind of like the ultimate. You know, if you're a basketball player, you know, you like want to climb in the NBA, and I'm not saying that I'm like that level in climbing, but for climbers to go to Pakistan and climb in this area, it's like the most amazing place, like beautiful peaks. And for someone like myself who's really into rock climbing, the quality of the rock there is really, really good. So it's potentially the most fun climbing. That said, and you'll see in the video, the conditions change a lot, and you don't always get what you hope for. So here we go.
Kilograms of stuff, and most expeditions would get two jeeps to carry everything, but we just use one. And that means we get to get an extra goat for the price of the jeep. So we'll be well fed.
Super pleasant up above, but we're seeing we don't care so much, we're gonna get started.
So this is what I was talking about before. Our hope was to free climb, and this is the very first pitch. We're already aid climbing just because the weather was so snowy.
Panning over here, we got four ledge camp. Panning down, we got first trunk. Josh and I are standing at the first belay of our route on Nappy's Cap. cracks above have a little dirt in them, and Jake's up there cleaning away. Jake? Josh and Willie team hauling from pitch two, working it one to one double team. There are the pigs, the first load coming up, the second load with our barrel and the haul bag beneath it. Wet.
So we had to haul all of those bags, and that was the hardest part of trying to climb this thing. We had to pull probably 400 pounds of gear up the wall with us, and so the two of them are using their body weight to lug the gear up the wall.
How many days had you planned to ascend?
We were hoping, we had planned on 10 days of food there, and we were hoping that we could do it in as few as 5 or 6, but we knew that there was a potential for bad weather, so we planned on a little extra, and it turned out it wasn't enough.
Okay, I'm going climbing July 9th. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. Where else are you going to be?
Somewhere up there in the clouds.
Spend a year in the orchard. May have as much as
it's July 10th, happy birthday, Dad. And we've got some snow coming down, some spindrift has come in, and it's kind of white. We had a big sucker hole last night, which made us think that we were going climbing today, but you can see this spot right here I excavated about 30 seconds ago, and it's filling up rapidly with snow in front of the door, but we're kind of letting it fill in because it gives us a bit more protection. Anyway, probably back inside the tents for more cowering.
There's Willie digging out one of Josh's portal leg. Waking up the little spindrift branches coming down. Kind of grim.
Yeah, so the question was, are our tents on ledges? And we're using porta ledges, which are an aluminum frame. It's kind of like a cot that you can haul up the wall, and they fold down into a small tube. And then there was a video of my friend Josh hammering on the wall earlier. He was drilling a bolt, and so we'll attach the ledges to the wall with a bolt.
So it's not a ledge that's part of the rock?
No. Yeah, it's a porta ledge, a hanging ledge, yeah. So we're hanging there about 1,000 feet above the glacier. Yeah, actually we did sleep a lot. You saw my friend Josh sleeping in that last clip of the video. And we did do a lot of sleeping because we weren't able to do as much climbing as we'd hoped.
Yeah, Willie. The Caricom is different from Yosemite. Yeah, Willie. How you doing, man? What do you think's a climbing day out there? Well, that's what we got going on right here. Yeah, we got that.
buried in our tent again. And Willie and Jake come to dig us out. Our whole wall collapsed. We had a few people holding it, but now it's toast. And the spindrift is coming hard. So our friends are digging us out while we brace the wall. What was that?
So that morning, it was like the other ones where there was lots of snow on us, and we had a piece of cord attaching the side of the tent to the wall to hold it out, because the spindrift is snow that just falls down the side of the slope, and it was piling up on the tent, and that piece of string broke, and so it all fell into the tent, and we were tied in, so we wouldn't have fallen anywhere, but it could have pushed the tent off the ledge, and we would have been dangling there, which would have been unfortunate. So anyway, that was probably the most grim morning, waking up that little clip before, and that was one of our last on the wall.
Here we are at our bivvy in pitch 5. We're going down, we're bailing, trying to get rid of all our stuff, bringing a couple of haul bags down, and the snow continues to fall.
It was like horrible luck. As soon as we touched down on the glacier, the weather cleared up, and we'd already packed it up and gone all the way down, and decided to pull the plug and get out of there, and the weather cleared. So we went back to base camp and ate a bunch of food and prepared to go back up for one last attempt. And on this next attempt, we didn't bring all the big haul bags and the other things along, because those slow us down. So we just brought smaller packs and tried to climb a bit faster, because we only had about 3 days at this point to try and make the ascent happen.
Well, it's July 13th and we're back for round 2 on Naffy's Cap. We bailed after capsule style attempt, our slow and heavy attempt after 9 days of sitting on the wall. So we're back to go light and fast. We've got, Willie's over there brewing us up, bringing that pack with one of those jet boils and 2 fuel canisters. We're bringing that little bullet pack. We're bringing that red Gravel pack there. Fat rack is on my waist. And a whole lot of sight to get us to the top. Anything to say?
Well, it's day 1. We haven't started climbing. And I already feel like a zombie.
Well, you haven't slept in over 24 hours, huh?
This is true.
Willie?
Colonel
Pedro and the North Factory of Karachi to pull us through this one.
That wrap there didn't fit extreme clothing.
Yeah, bring us to the top of the Naffy's Cap.
Ben leading out on pitch 2. The route yet to be named. Cruising right along.
That's an ape call.
Previously wickedly icy M4 climbed in rock shoes ditch. I think it's still heinous. Up ahead you can see the head wall. Where we're going. A little ribbon crack. It looks like a ribbon crack. It's actually probably a terrible, awful, heinous chimney where we're shooting for. Nice work, Ben. Looking down, you can see pretty nice crack, a little snow in it. And down, down, down.
to more snowy crack, and the icy chimney is below, and then crevasses down the glacier below. Willie is coming up with his incredibly heavy backpack, and I'm sure he's not having fun right now. Yeah, Willie! Doing good, man!
Well, welcome to Shea Pitch 5. For on the menu tonight, we have the Natural High Classic Barbecue Beef with mashed potatoes. What do you have, Willie?
I have none other than mountain chili for when we're in the mountains.
Perfect.
We scored this food from our friend at base camp. And here we are, it's a beautiful night, it's a beautiful night.
Can't see it, but there's a beautiful moon. We're having an open divvy on Nappy's cap.
So you may have thought that the portal edges sound a little scary and small, but in this little clip of the video, we're sitting on a ledge that's just barely big enough for our butts. And that's how we spent the night, was just cuddling each other and sitting on that ledge until daylight came. And then we started climbing again. So you may notice we sound a little tired and fatigued, and we were. It was definitely tiring. And we were also at about 18,000 feet there, so altitude played a role as well.
We're all tired. We've been up for almost 24 hours.
Here goes Jake heading up into the beautiful crescent moon splitters.
Oh my gosh.
Wideness.
They're fat. I think they're going to be strenuous.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah! Yeah! Oh, yeah! Yeah!
Cool. Great. Well, that's the video. So I realize I have a lot more slides and a lot more stories than I could possibly fit into the next like 15 or 10 minutes that we have left. So I guess I'd like to open it up to question. Maybe I can show some photos that speak to those questions and answer the questions you have.
You going back? You going to try it again?
You know, at this point, I don't really feel that strong of a desire to go back there. At one point, Jake made a reference to, so this is the difference between climbing in Yosemite versus the Karakoram, and that's when Willie came into the tent all covered in snow. And so California, obviously, is much sunnier and nicer, and when you go to California, you actually climb a lot more rock. And so I have some free time in August, and I'll be going to California.
You said you slept on, horrible ledges.
Have I ever slept in a suspended hammock? No, usually we'll either bring a portal edge or there'll be natural ledges on the wall. The one night, the second attempt when we were sleeping on the little ledges, just sitting there, was not too bad. We actually could sleep a fair amount. It sounds horrible, but it's not so bad. Some people do use portable hammocks for climbing on the wall, and 50 years ago, that was the way people did it. But it's much less comfortable because you're bowed out and it's hard to get it set up exactly right. So the portal edge is preferable when you can. Yeah.
Do you climb with the same team most of the time when you go on these trips?
No, it's, compiling a team for an expedition like this is the hardest part. So I'd wanted to go to Pakistan for many years. I'd heard about it from some Belgian climbers who showed me a video of their climb there, and I was really inspired to go. And you try to find people who have the experience and who will be good partners. And the most important thing, I think, is just finding partners who are going to be excited and stay positive through times like that. Because inevitably on a trip like this, you're going to have hard times. It's not going to be fun carrying the loads up to the base. you're going to have to sit through snowy times like that. So it's so true that the people that you're with are much more, their ability to remain optimistic and positive is way more important than their climbing ability. That said, so this is Willie on the left. Willie and I have climbed together a number of times, and he's a very talented climber. Jake and I had spent a month climbing in Yosemite just before this trip and worked really well as a team. And Josh is the guy in black, and he and I have worked several mountaineering and climbing courses together and done a number of personal climbing trips. So they're all people that I had a tremendous amount of trust in and felt really good going on the trip with. So yeah, that's a huge consideration. I wouldn't ever go on a trip like this without people that I really trusted and knew deeply. Yeah.
What's like the most danger you've ever encountered?
The most danger? Let's see if I have a photo of it. In some of the videos you can actually hear the ice fall in the background. So here are some photos of us moving up the glacier. And you can see, like right here where the cursor is, that's called a hanging glacier. And so it's just compressed snow that turns into ice, you know, and they work their ways down the valleys, and that's what carves out this whole area. And constantly while you're in these valleys, you hear the calving off of the ice falling down and collapsing. And that's the biggest danger in this area is walking underneath those areas. So just over here on the left, there was an ice fall that we had to walk fairly close to. And we thought we had picked a safe way through there. And we would always move really quickly through that spot because we knew there was the potential for ice to come through. And while we were sitting on the wall, we were observing that ice fall for 10 days. And we most of the time were thinking, oh, like we chose a good route, that seems safe. And then one day, like the whole thing fell and wiped out that entire path. And it was like, wow, I'm glad we weren't standing there at that moment because we wouldn't have been in good shape. So I think that's the scariest part of a trip like this is just like navigating the ice falls in these regions because the actual rock climbing itself is relatively safe. Like we can control a lot of the risks. There's not that much that's going to fall on us because we chose a very steep overhanging line that if anything did fall, it falls beyond us. So it's relatively safe once you're on the wall. It's getting to the wall that's the most risky part. Yeah. So this is Jake coming through a crevasse, and that was crossing the little piece of the glacier. We did have a satellite phone, and we would call friends every so often to get a weather report. Some people pay professionals to forecast the weather, and there was actually another American expedition in our camp, and they were paying someone to get a forecast. So we had the advantage of being able to get the forecast from them. So that's a huge advantage of climbing in the mountains these days is that you have satellite phones, and you can have, and some people even bring satellite phones with internet connections, so you can upload to your blog while you're at base camp. And we didn't want to do that. Yeah.
You said they gave you two goats at the beginning of the trip. What
yeah.
was the benefit of that?
Okay. So the goats. let's see. Do I have a photo of the goat? Here's a goat bathing in the water. So it's a tradition with the Balti porters, that's the local porters in the region, to bring a goat along on the hike up. So we had 23 porters to carry our bags up to the base of the area, and then we took over from there and carried everything else. But it's a tradition that you have to buy a goat for the porters, and then halfway up they'll slaughter the goat and eat it. So we had one goat for the porters and then one goat for ourselves to eat later. So that was our main source of meat up there because you can't really go to a butcher in Pakistan or a grocery store where they sell meat. You go buy a goat and you do it yourself. So, yeah. other questions?
Do Ben, how much vertical did you climb? What was the total vertical you made, and how much did you still have to go?
All right, let's see. I'll find a...
Did you consider staying a little longer to try to get that last piece?
Yeah, so let's see. It was a tough debate for us as a team on the wall. We were a little bit divided in making the decision to leave the first time when we were in the portal edges. After sitting through those 3 days of snow, we were about to run out of food, and so we had to make the decision: are we going to go down, or are we going to try and like stick it out and go to the top without potentially having enough food? And at that point, when we were making that decision, we were right here. And so we had to go there. And that's actually not the top. There's a little bit more above it. So from there, we figured it would take us like one and then two more moves to get to the top. So at this point, the base of the route there is about 16,500 feet. And this was probably about 17,500 feet. And the top was just under 20,000 feet. So you may have heard of El Capitan in Yosemite, which is about 3,000 feet total. And that's at about sea level, more or less. And so this is like El Cap on top of like the tallest peak in the 48 states. So we ultimately made the decision to go down just because we felt like we were running out of food. And we were starting to be concerned about the amount of snow. It seemed like the weather pattern was not really favorable for us, and we were concerned about avalanches and, you know, a bit concerned about what could potentially happen for our safety. So, yeah.
How much of the mountain would you get through a day of climbing?
So how much of the mountain you can get through in a day depends largely on the strategy you're climbing with. So when we went up there with all the haul bags and everything, we got to this point at that first big ledge. It took us 5 days to get everything set to go up there because the weather was so bad. And we were also installing anchors along the way, which takes more time. And on our second attempt, when we were just carrying those smaller backpacks, we got to this point in about 5 hours. And then we climbed up here to this point in another couple hours. So in one day, we got to this point, which is about 1,500 feet off the ground. And we were optimistic that we could do something like this in just one day, because Jake and I had spent a lot of time climbing in Yosemite, and we'd climbed El Cap 3,000 feet in just over 12 hours. So we thought we could storm up this thing. It turned out we were a little more ambitious and a little more arrogant than reality would have it. So maybe a perspective scale, you might have that photo where Jake was about to climb those really wide crescent moon cracks we were talking about. That was right here. So that wall looked really big from that perspective, and from down here it looks tiny. Other questions?
Now that you did one of your dream mountains, what's your next
plan? So I've taken a little break from climbing. leading up to this trip, I was climbing more or less nonstop for 6 years or so. It was like all I did anytime I had any free time. And I think being up there, I was like reflecting a lot on like, why do I do this? What is the point? And I still enjoy climbing. I still love it. And I like have plans to do more in the future, and I still do it. But I don't do it with the same intensity, I think. And currently I'm training for an Ironman triathlon. So that's been my focus, is just swimming, biking, and running. And so that's been keeping me busy. So that's my next mountain right now. Yeah.
What's more strenuous on your body, the climbing or preparing for the
Ironman? You know, I've trained for the Ironman with a lot more discipline, and I think that's part of the reason I wanted to do the Ironman, was because I realized like I could approach climbing in the mountains with more strategy, because I worked really hard to get ready for this trip, and I think I was in good shape, but still, I was struggling to hike to the base of this thing when we first got there because of the altitude. At 17,000 feet, just to like walk up a gentle slope was like very challenging. And so I think there's a lot of strategy you can bring to that, and learning to perform at altitude is a skill. It takes a long time to get really good at that. And you learn from reading the experiences of other people that the first time they go, they don't excel right away. And there are a lot of things they do to prepare and get it right so that their body is performing as well as it can in those conditions. So both are really strenuous, but I think this is more mentally taxing too. Yeah?
You ever thought about climbing Mount Everest?
You know, I don't really have much interest in climbing Mount Everest. This has kind of been my ideal, is climbing this style peak where we're just climbing rock and climbing in a place where there are no other people. So we were in this valley for 2 months, and we didn't see like any other people climbing on this wall. There was one other group that was at our base camp with us, and they were doing something totally different. So Everest is very crowded, and it's also different because people are putting fixed ropes up for you, and you're just following that path. And that's not to say that climbing Everest is easy or not interesting. It's just, for me, like, I'm more interested in climbing pure rock like this and doing something a little more remote. Yeah. Well, is that about all the time we have?
One more question.
Okay. Last question.
You got an environmental club.
Yeah.
Do you bring all your stuff out of there? Now, Everest is junk all over the place.
We do, yeah. We and then some too. There was some leftover garbage at the base camp from previous expeditions, and we had 20 some porters come in to help us get all our things out. So we ate 3 porters worth of food. Each porter carries 20 kilograms worth of stuff, so we ate about that much, and then other people took things down. So we carried all of our garbage out, and that's definitely a huge part of our climbing ethic, is that we remove everything from the mountain, and especially ropes. Like, we didn't want to leave any ropes on the peak. So yeah. All right, thank you.